This is an Apple II GS that I recently picked up on eBay. It came complete with drives, but included no software. Today, I aim to fix that. Hi, I'm Matt D'Amico, and welcome to episode 3 of Retro Bits. Happy Memorial Day weekend. I hope you're all doing well and staying safe during these difficult times. Myself, I'm staying in this weekend, so why not make another video? Let me start off by saying that I don't know much about Apple IIs from this era. My family had a 2C back in the day, but I only used it for word processing and playing some games, so I'm learning a lot of this stuff for the first time now. You probably noticed that the machine didn't come with an Apple monitor. So I cobbled up a quick and dirty adapter that connects an Apple DB15 or Atari ST DIN 13 AV output to any Commodore RGB monitor that accepts DIN or DB9 RGB input. Now I do plan to do a more comprehensive video on this machine in the future and fix some issues that it has, but for today, I just want to get some software onto the machine and try it out. The problem we face is that PCs use an MFM encoding on their drives, whereas Apple IIs of this era use GCR or group code recording. What this means is it's not feasible to write Apple software on a modern PC. It can be done, but you need a special drive, controller, and software, and apparently the software only works on pre-NT kernel Windows machines, so ME and earlier. So, assuming we have no other systems with GCR drives available to us, how do we get software to our Apple II? Enter ADTPro. This super handy piece of software not only allows you to transfer many common disk image formats straight to your machine, but it also allows you to bootstrap your machine with no existing media. It is capable of booting itself via network, serial port, or even cassette interface, and works with any Apple II or III machine, provided they have sufficient RAM and one of the supported I/O devices. The ADTPro server runs on Windows, Mac, and Linux machines, and is available for free at the link in the description. To connect your Apple II up, you'll need a mini DIN serial cable connected to the modem port. I further attached a DB25 to DB9 null modem and a gender changer to this PC USB serial port dongle. For the 2GS, make sure slot 2 is set up as a modem and accept the default system settings in the control panel for the modem port. In the ADTPro server, configure your COM port and accept the default speed settings. In the bootstrapping menu, select ProDOS Speedy Boot. You must then boot your Apple into BASIC by hitting Control Break as soon as it starts booting. ADTPro will prompt you to enter several commands and then the process begins. IN2 directs BASIC to accept input from slot 2, in this case the serial port. Control A sends command characters to the card in slot 2, and 14B sets the baud rate of the device to 9600 baud, as described in the Apple II serial port firmware interface commands. Upon clicking the OK dialog, the server begins sending commands over the serial port that direct the Apple to enter the machine language monitor and input the ADTPro client code directly. It completely blows my mind that Apple IIs had this capability all the way back in the 80s. Even in the 90s, only high-end servers could boot from a network interface until PXE booting became commonplace. ADTPro is a clever hack, but it highlights how much thought went into designing these machines in the first place. Once the software loads, you have the ability to perform some basic disk operations such as formatting a floppy. Once that's complete, you can use the receive function to download a bootable copy of the ADTPro software to disk for future use. The transfer is surprisingly fast. In this example, I'm copying an 800K 3.5-inch floppy image to disk. It would be significantly faster to copy the 140K image to a 5.25-inch disk, but that drive doesn't work properly, so it'll be looked at in a future episode. Let me take a second to apologize for all the CRT footage. I don't currently have a method of capturing video directly from the 2GS, but I'm working on a solution for next time. So there we go, our first bootable floppy. If my napkin math is correct, the average transfer rate was right around 51 kilobits per second. Not bad for 1986. So now that I can transfer software to the machine, I can set it up and start using it. So that's it for now. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time on Retro Bits.